On a cloudy day, when it's cold outside, I've got the money. Everybody say,
I guess you say,
what
can make me feel this way?
It's my girl.
Hello, everybody. It is Friday, March the 15th, 2024. Tech is in the news, as always, dominated by this TikTok issue. The House, a couple of days ago, passed the bill that would, that could, at least according to the Washington Post, ban the app in the US. The Wall Street Journal reports that Steven Mnuchin, who had been, I think, Trump's Treasury Secretary, is putting together a group to buy TikTok. And of course, Keith Teer, the author of That Was the Week, tech newsletter, which focuses on the week in tech, is focusing this week on TikTok. He has an AI-produced image, which presents a man in front of a map of the world, Keith, looking rather confusedly at it. And the title of the newsletter this week is Ban Foreigners Owning Key Assets? Is this why this guy's confused in your image?
I think he's not confused. He's contemplating. He's meant to be American, clearly. There's American flags everywhere. He is contemplating national policy as it pertains to assets, which I thought is super funny when you think about it, Andrew. I mean, which country in the world owns most assets outside of their borders in other countries? America, right? And how many of those assets are key? All of them. It's like oil and natural resources and pharmaceuticals. There's all kinds of stuff. So here's America saying, it's not okay for foreigners to own assets in another country. It's super.
What's your take on what's happening here, Keith? I mean, it's on one level absurd and humorous, on another level very disturbing. Is it just the rise of xenophobia, both on the left and the right in American politics? It seems Biden and Trump, for example, are on a relatively similar page on this one.
Well, look, I think there's some facts that are correct. For example, the Chinese government does have policies which impact what TikTok does and doesn't do inside China. Because ByteDance, the owner, was originally Chinese, it's now 60% American owned by big banks mainly. But, just like Google is subject to US laws, TikTok is subject to Chinese laws. And just as in America, the government is the ultimate authority, so too in China. In China, it happens to be the Chinese Communist Party. Here, it happens to be some blend of Republicans and Democrats. So the facts do say, okay, this is not a wholly US thing. But even when it is a US thing, they want to control it. In the House, as we talk about often. So I don't think there's really a genuine threat. I think it's politics.
What's the best argument? Is it that Google isn't allowed to be distributed in China?
It isn't true.
It's not a tit for tat thing?
No, because Google is allowed to be in China and chose to pull out. They chose to leave a few years ago.
To their credit, I think.
Whereas Apple didn't.
But Apple is slightly different. They manufacture a lot of their products in China, whereas Google is a front-end web product. What about Facebook?
No, but wait, Andrew, 50% of Chinese smartphone owners use iPhones and the App Store. So it's not just hardware.
Yeah, but they also control what you can and can't see in the App Store. What what you can access in the App Store in the US is different from what you can access in the App Store in China. Isn't that right?
Totally true. But one of the things you can access is WeChat. And WeChat is pretty much ubiquitous amongst anyone in China with a smartphone. And that's where private conversations take place. And that's completely, you know, they have keyword catching to block things like Tiananmen Square. But every government does that. I mean, I don't think the Chinese government's any more
permissive. So is this just... I've used this word, we used it last week as well, virtue signaling, at least in what virtue is on the part of the American government. Are they serious about this? Is this just pre-election nonsense or is it for real? And does it suggest a descent into economic nationalism in the 2020s?
That economic nationalism must be part of it, but it isn't a pure narrative because, for example, Trump is against the TikTok ban. But quite a few Republicans who are.
Although he seems ambivalent, as always with Trump, you're never quite sure what he thinks.
He probably doesn't
know himself what he thinks. It just depends on what benefits him.
Correct.
Why is Biden? I mean, this is not a politics show, but why it's not just Joe Biden, but the Biden administration. Why are they pushing a TikTok ban?
I think there's massive sensitivities about being seen to be soft on, you know, there's a list, right? Migrants and China are two of the things on the list. TikTok is a proxy for China, really, even though it shouldn't be. That's how they use it.
Yeah.
And so I think it's a sign of the opportunism in politics to speak to the crowd or what they think is the crowd. In this case, I think they may have called it wrong. I mean, I don't detect any... You know, my kids use TikTok and I don't detect any negativity. They fully know who owns it.
Well, why would they care?
Why would they care? Yeah, I mean, the reason they use it, by the way, is because it's really good.
Well, you can't blame the Chinese for that. What about the argument made by some people that China has access to all this data on TikTok, the Chinese government? What does that even mean?
Well, let's assume they could see 100% of the data, which of course they can't. But let's
on TikTok what people. You and I can go on TikTok and find out what people are saying.
No, but I mean, let's pretend they've got access to the log files, and they can put them through database parsers and try to figure out trends. Or let's imagine they can use those log files to target political messages to individuals more susceptible to listening to those messages based on profiling them. So even in the most extreme scenario where they're really pulling all the strings, which is clearly fake, they're not doing that. What's the harm? I mean, where's the damage? I still don't think they can brainwash people into believing things they don't already believe. So I just don't see the problem, actually. I think it's a fake problem. And it's insecure politicians. That may not be why they do it, but they clearly are insecure about controlling the message. And they hate it when the message may be out of their control. And let's be honest, for the last 20 years, day by day, the message is more and more out of their control. And by them, I mean politicians, mainstream media. The message doesn't emerge anymore from the old channels. Usually it was American-owned businesses. Now it's...
Yeah, and if this is, as you say, 60% owned by American banks, why would the Chinese care anyway?
The Chinese, if they care at all, and I suspect they don't.
They're rather amused, I would guess.
Probably amused.
The Americans look very mature.
But if they did care, the only reason they'd care is to get a better understanding through data of America. And, you know, ultimately that probably would be a good thing for the world if everyone had a better understanding of each other's population.
Yeah, I mean, it's rather painful, Keith, for me to agree so wholehearted with you. Usually you and I disagree on stuff. I mean, this is just absurd, and it's united the tech press. The information, which we're going to talk about later, is against it. The EFF is against it, although one would expect that. Vox is against it. I mean, everybody is against this.
Well, not everybody. I mean,
everyone within the tech media. Is anyone in Silicon Valley in any way sympathetic to this?
I could be speaking out of turn here, but I think
I think
the All In podcast people are split, but some of them are for it.
That's Calacanis.
David Sachs, probably. And I think that Elon is probably for it, but you can imagine why he might be for it. It clearly helps Twitter if TikTok is damaged. And when we say for it, by the way, it probably should be clear. The bill requires a breakup. It requires ByteDance to sell TikTok to an American owner. And the Mnuchin thing is close to corruption, I think, because Mnuchin was somebody who fought for TikTok to be treated as a special case from a regulatory point of view, and is now popping up as a possible buyer with a consortium. Whoa, I mean, that is kind of crazy.
And I'm guessing that the Facebook people are rather enjoying this. First, it takes the spotlight off them, and secondly, it can't be bad for Facebook, which is, with Instagram, the most natural competitor to TikTok, isn't it?
I think it would like to be, but it's not even close. I mean, TikTok dominates that short form video. It doesn't dominate other things. So if TikTok is thinking of producing a photo app that would compete with Instagram, because Instagram is far ahead when it comes to photos. But I think they all are laughing all the way to the bank, because anything that harms TikTok helps them, which you would think would be antitrust on the face of it. I mean, if Lena Khan was watching, she'd have to defend.
You couldn't resist bringing up your girlfriend, Keith, Lena Khan.
Well, surely she'd have to defend TikTok.
Isn't she shocked? And wouldn't she be shocked with this? I mean,
I have no idea. I can't read her mind. But
Lena, if you're watching, we need to know how you feel about TikTok.
It would be anti-competitive to get rid of them, that's for sure.
I mean, what's the most direct competitor then to TikTok in the US? Is it YouTube?
I think YouTube is close, but a latecomer as well to this particular format. You know, it's interesting how consumer apps, the format is everything. I think it's the same as doing TV, by the way. The guests and the substance are important, but the format is what triggers people.
Is TikTok, does it have legs in the long term? Could it be?
Yes.
A short form success, but in the long run it goes away?
I doubt it, because it's dopamine fueling. What it does, I watch my wife Jenna is a TikTok enthusiast, and she can spend, you know, in her downtime in the evening, instead of binge watching TV for 2 hours, she can literally spend 2 hours on TikTok, and I hear her laughing, belly laughing, chortling, because it feeds the stuff that she finds funny. And the algorithm there is so good at repeat, you know, experiences, but different content.
How do you feel, Keith, about your wife being in the control of the Chinese government? Is this the Manchurian candidate all over again?
You know,
if she starts spouting the propaganda of Xi and the Chinese Communist Party after watching TikTok?
I think based on where her and I are politically, I'd accuse her of becoming more right-wing if that was to happen.
Well, we agree 100% on this one. I hope it goes away. It probably won't. What else is happening this week? A relatively quiet week outside TikTok. You had an interesting piece about in the newsletter this week on the Vision Pro as an over-engineered dev kit. What does that mean?
Dev kit. So this is coming from one of the founders of Oculus, who was acquired by Facebook and has the Quest 3D face mask. He's a very experienced and thoughtful guy. He says a lot of good things about the Vision Pro, but he says, whereas other people say it is a version one, he calls it a dev kit, which is less than a version one. It's where it's mainly built for developers to get familiar with.
You have one. Is it version one or a dev kit?
I used it yesterday to construct the newsletter, which is the first time I've used it to do a piece of work. I don't think it's a version one yet, because I couldn't complete my task on it. I had to take it off.
You're regretting that $3,500 you spent?
No, because just watching movies on it over a year will pay for that, I think. It's
what happens if you put it on and you look at TikTok? Do you become controlled by the Chinese government?
TikTok does have an app for it, and it's a super good
implementation. Oh, wow, now we're getting to the truth.
But, to be honest, I used it once.
We need to doubly ban it. AI, of course, remains in the news. An interesting piece from Strange Loop Canon, a good Substack essay on how LLMs have special intelligence, not general, but that's pretty impressive. And interestingly enough, it's Claude 3, which is leading the leaderboard at the moment. It beats ChatGPT, beats Gemini. How impressed are you with Claude, Keith? I know we've talked about this before. And what does Strange Loop Canon tell us about LLMs in terms of their special intelligence?
So Strange Loop Canon is the newsletter of Rohit Krishnan. I strongly recommend reading it. He's a really good writer.
Yeah, I just subscribed. He has 10,000 subscribers, so he's clearly doing something right.
Yeah, he's super smart. He's British. And
he's not Chinese, I hope.
No, if he was anything, he'd be Indian, I think, with a name like Rohit Krishnan, but he's British. And he's a deep thinker. He's very numerate, very data savvy. And what he writes here is just a clarification, really. It rings close to what we discussed initially when we talked about ChatGPT. And that is to say that these things are really good at specific things. And if that's your job, if any of the things they're good at is your job, it's going to save you a lot of time and make you better at your job. And that's what he calls special knowledge as opposed to general intelligence. And I think that's exactly right. Your Claude 3 question is interesting because I've been using OpenAI for SQL programming for probably a year now. And it is very good. I tried Claude 3 over the last 2 weeks, and it is better. It's definitely better.
So you have to acknowledge, Keith, you're wrong, because you've been telling me for months that OpenAI is miles ahead of, and ChatGPT is miles ahead of everyone else. You're wrong. You were wrong now.
Well, I'd put it this way. Claude 3 has caught up and maybe surpassed it a little bit in some areas, but that's a year after GPT-4 was shipped. I'm going to guess that OpenAI is close to GPT.
Is this going to be like the wacky races where every week someone else is ahead? I mean,
yes,
in the rankings that Krishna writes about, Gemini isn't far behind. They get 99.6%. ChatGPT gets 99.99%. Claude gets 99.9999%. So they're all pretty close, right?
They're close, but remember, those are IQ numbers, and you and me have IQs bigger than that.
Well, speak for yourself.
So he's saying that they're as smart probably as an entering undergraduate in university as a kind of an average.
Which I don't know whether we should be chilled by that or pleased.
But in specialist subjects, they're way better.
Well, when it comes to fear of AI, you had two interesting pieces in the newsletter this week. One from the Wall Street Journal about how OpenAI's AI videos are so good that they should freak us out. And another about an AI video that will blow your mind and maybe even scare you, an OpenAI video. How impressive is all this video OpenAI, or not OpenAI, video AI, Keith? And is OpenAI leading here?
Well, it's interesting. The Wall Street Journal interviews the CTO of OpenAI, and she in the interview points out the flaws in the video. For example, there's a bull in a China shop video where the bull is trampling all over China, but the China, meaning...
You brought out the Chinese again, Keith.
Exactly. Cups and saucers.
It wasn't cups and saucers, it was Beijing and Shanghai.
But the bull is trampling all over the China and the China doesn't break. So she points out that, look, it isn't perfect because it doesn't understand...
But that's a metaphor for American failure to deal with the Chinese, isn't it?
Could be. could definitely, we could certainly shoehorn that into the conversation without any doubt.
So what is OpenAI? What is the OpenAI videos? Why is it so impressive and scary?
It's impressive because, and she breaks it down, you know, there's 60 frames a second in video, somewhere between 24 and 60, depending on the format you use. And every frame has to be organically connected to the frame before, plus the change. And for an AI in a minute to produce 60 times 60 frames that lead to a linear video that looks as if it was filmed is already very impressive. And the fact that it can pick characters, scenes, you know, objects within the scene, and follow everything through frame by frame, can do that based on you giving it just some text, a storyline, if you will. No, there's no doubt that's
how hard would it be? I mean, you've got your image, which you use some of the graphic AI to create at the beginning about an American staring at a screen of the world. How hard would it be to turn that into video?
I'm sure if when they release Sora, I'll be able to say, give me a 30-second video of that scene where the guy stands up and throws a tomato at, you know, the screen at the end, and it will be able to do it.
So when the pieces talk about forgetting Sora, they're saying that OpenAI's video is already really impressive and Sora's going to blow it away.
No. So Sora and OpenAI is the same thing.
No, I understand. So even now, pre-Sora, OpenAI has an impressive video tool.
Now the second one you're showing with the robot in, that's actually different. That is a robot made by
Figure AI.
And they've made a robot, and this video is a demo of the robot interacting with a human being, carrying out tasks that the human asks it to do, including giving him some fruit to eat, stacking some dishes in a dryer, various things, with verbal feedback. They talk to each
other. Sounds like what a husband does with their wife.
In my case, it's the wife.
Fruit.
My wife walks into the kitchen and says, there's some cleaning up to be done, and then leaves.
Well, then she goes back to watching TikTok. She's obviously been programmed by the Chinese. Then you should take her to the doctor.
I should.
Well, yeah. OpenAI is scary. But there is some normal stuff still going on. An interesting piece. Everyone kind of wrote Coinbase off last year, but they seem to be coming back. They raised $1 billion through convertible notes. is crypto coming back?
Well, you have to say yes to that. Look, Bitcoin, I haven't looked today.
Yeah, we talked last week about the price of Bitcoin. I'm not sure what the numbers are this week.
It got to 70-something thousand dollars at one point this week. I don't know if it's still there. And somebody in the chat can tell us. And the associated crypto coins like Ethereum and Solana have also gone up massively. So I think you do have to say crypto is back. It's mainly Bitcoin centric. However, the ETF that BlackRock built on the stock exchanges now has more than $10 billion of money flowing into it. Graycroft, Gray something, maybe Grayscale, but the one that was already in existence, it has something like $90 billion. And there's a company that simply buy MicroStrategy, I think it's called, that only buys Bitcoin with its cash. It has the largest pool of Bitcoin, and its stock price has gone up in
my prediction will be that this will come back to bite us. We'll see. It's always easy to predict these things. Meanwhile, Stripe continues to do well. I think they announced that they weren't going to do an IPO this week, but their growth continue, at least according to TechCrunch, continues to impress. As total payment volume tops $1 trillion. Tell me about Stripe and their place in the new world, Keith.
Well, look, it's a kind of a known thing in startup world that you should go to a VC with a deck, and you should give them a big number. In Stripe's case, that big number is the world's GDP, which is about 120 trillion. And you should say, we think we can get 1% of this big number. And then VCs, if they believe you, should give you money. In Stripe's case, they've done it. I mean, $1 trillion is close to 1% of global GDP, and it's flowing through their payment system, which is embedded in most websites and apps. So that's astonishing.
And what percentage of that comes back to Stripe? What's the revenue model?
It'll be super tiny because it's the...
Right, but a 0.0001% of $1 trillion is a lot of money.
It'll be more than 1%.
More than 1%?
Yeah. Because they have transaction fees.
Why don't they do an IPO?
They'll choose their time. I think it's interesting. The Reddit IPO is going to take place next week. I didn't put it in the...
Yeah, that's not a very interesting one. But Stripe is part of the new plumbing, isn't it? I mean,
well, there is a correlation. The currency of an IPO is free cash flow and the rate of growth of the free cash flow. So that is to say, after you've paid all your bills, including your taxes and everything, how much is left over? And how fast is that number growing? Now, in the case of Reddit, it's not a good answer. And in the case of Stripe, I suspect it's also not a good answer. So exposing yourself to public markets, you have to have growth, percentage growth from a base that is, good enough for the market. And then they will give you a multiple valuation on that. You know, Reddit is IPOing at only 6x its revenue, which is low, because the normal market for a company like Reddit would be, 10 to 20 times its revenue. So 6x is on the low side. And that's because the stock market as a whole has got what we call depressed multiples. I think Stripe is going to try to time it so that it isn't hammered in its valuation. Reddit's going out at 6 billion. Its prior private valuation was 3x bigger than that.
Well, you would think that this would suggest that Keith would have given either Reddit or Stripe startup of the week, but he hasn't. He's gone for the information, which it's an encouraging story, Keith, because we do so many stories on the crisis of journalism and the collapse of all these online publications. The information this week got honored with 5 Best in Business Journalism Awards. It's a good story. It's a good product. What is the information doing well, right, that everybody else is doing wrong?
Well, the first thing it's doing is proper journalism. It actually goes and seeks out stories and facts. And
but everyone, anyone can do that if they've got the resources.
Well, it's also doing, I don't know if everyone, we'll come back to that. But so let's stick on the first answer. They're doing good journalism. They're doing good investigation. They are focusing in on stories that actually matter to the tech world, which is their audience. So they're not writing fluff pieces for the most part. Almost everything is meaningful, and when you read it, it forces you to consider it. I think that's really good. I think Jessica Lessin seems to be an extremely good CEO. She has built a very good team, and she doesn't, she doesn't lead from the front, as in this is all about me.
Yeah, she's certainly no Mike Arrington, is she?
She definitely is not a Mike Arrington, but we love Mike Arrington. So,
speak for yourself. Of course, she's married to Facebook money. Have they invested huge amounts into the information? What's that? Their business model is, of course, subscription. It's hard to get access. I used to subscribe, but it was rather expensive. But it's probably worth it. Is their entire business model based on subscription?
It is. I think it is. And it's, as you say, it's not cheap. I'm a subscriber, and I've forgotten how much.
You have to be as Mr. Investment, you have to keep up with stuff. Was a large amount of money put in by perhaps her family and their friends?
I don't believe it was, Andrew. I think I mean, you know, I should be careful here because I actually don't know the facts, but
yeah,
my impression is it was bootstrapped from the beginning. With
very good- impressive. And you have to assume that the New York Times, which is always desperate for acquisitions, or the Washington Post,
yeah,
or the Wall Street Journal, they'd all give Jessica Lessing a blank check for the information.
Yeah. Well, you know, it sits alongside Axios and Politico and The Atlantic.
But it makes money in contrast to The Atlantic. It's not some philanthropic thing.
Yeah, it does make money. And it does. They do events. I actually think they leave a lot of money on the table because they do have the gravitas to do events that people would show up to. I look at Connie Loizos at TechCrunch, who now runs TechCrunch for its owners. And she's very good with her newsletter, Strictly VC, which is now owned by TechCrunch. Strictly VC does these events that sell out. I do think that journalism and events go together super well. And the information does do some events, but I think it could actually make a lot of money doing them better.
And presumably Lessing isn't desperate to sell out in terms of
New York
going to the bank herself, that she already has money in the family.
Yeah, I don't know her personally, so I can't judge that, but
it's a good story, and it should be a model for other journalism startups. Does it suggest that there are opportunities in other verticals? The Athletic, of course, sold to the New York Times, but the information focuses on tech. I presume that they're not thinking of going into other verticals.
There are others, Andrew. Do you read Unheard in the UK?
Yeah.
So well,
yeah,
it's good. I mean,
I don't like its politics. You probably like, it's a sort of libertarian, a right-wing libertarian thing.
Well, it depends. Like Jake Ferrady, who's the son of my former professor, Frank Ferrady, is an editor there. And he's definitely, I wouldn't characterize him politically, actually. He's just a curious investor.
Yeah.
And he's super good. That team, it's really all about the team. I mean, the information starts with Jessica Lessing. I think Unheard starts with Jake Ferrady and a couple of others.
Is Ferrady the editor at Unheard?
He's not the executive editor, but he's one level down from that. But they do all the work, basically.
Well, congratulations on the information. They have the most important award, Keith Startup of the Week. And finally, it wouldn't be that was the week unless Keith was writing about his hero, Elon Musk. And we have an ex from Cyan Bannister, herself a distinguished figure in Silicon Valley. Thanking Elon Musk.
It's worth reading out, actually, Andrew.
Yeah, I'll read it out. Many periods during our history, we would have built statues of Elon and celebrated him. Let's not wait to do it posthumously, as so many have done with others, but instead celebrate him today and continue to cheer him on. In the face of great adversity, he and his team continue to astonish and bring humanity to greater and greater technological advancements. And of course, what she's talking about is SpaceX, for what she says, doing the unthinkable, launching a giant Starship rocket into space. Although I'm not sure she covers this. It did get lost in the Indian Ocean. But I assume you agree with Bannister, Keith?
Yeah, it got lost on re-entry. And it did re-enter, which is the largest object to ever re-enter the Earth's atmosphere. So re-entry was not a non-trivial operation, as was getting into orbit a non-trivial operation, and it succeeded at both. And then sometime between re-entry and landing, they didn't have control over it anymore.
Probably the Chinese took it over.
But it does mean that, you know, he does these experiments to learn, and this is the third of these. And
he doesn't do them just for himself, does he?
No, but the prior two had worse problems earlier. And so he's basically pushing the envelope by, you know, accepting mistakes, learning from them, and then let's make a different later mistake. My guess is the next time he does it, it will re-enter and it won't be lost. And then you have a huge starship that's capable of taking very large payloads a very long distance, which is a massive breakthrough.
He doesn't, I mean, I take a point, but he doesn't do a lot to help his own reputation.
You can say that.
I mean, he clearly doesn't care, or he goes out of his way to be disliked.
A lot of people cheered him on this week when he decided not to partner with Don Lemon. You would think.
Yeah. What did you make of that? I don't know why he did it in the first place.
Yeah, it's hard to tell. I think we have to wait until we see the interview. But Don Lemon is self-obsessed kind of narcissist. And so is Elon. So
yeah, although Elon is a biggest. I don't know anything about Lemon.
Yeah, well, I think he's a bit full of himself, let's put it that way. That neither one of them are particularly humble, and so it was never going to work, and it sure enough it didn't. But Elon has the purse strings when it comes to X, so his show was cancelled. A bit like Apple cancelling John Stewart, which I have actually more concern about that, because that was because they didn't like what he was saying.
And should we? I mean, I'm not suggesting that Bannister was doing this to get more followers on X, which is owned by Musk. But should we be concerned in a week, Keith, where we're worried about the supposed totalitarian Chinese government? Should we be concerned that this sort of thing, these sorts of statements, this hero worship is being articulated on the very platform that Musk owns and uses to peddle his own statues, or at least try to encourage people to build statues for himself?
You know, Dennis Pombriant, who's on the Gilmore Gang, his quote was sideshow. And I think that's probably just about right, because in the real world, leading up to November, there are real issues about the future of our lives. And those probably should be center stage, not the personalities. I'm not a big, I hate watching these TV shows that, you know, reiterate Trump's history over and over again, as if that is enough to defeat him. But on actual issues, it feels as if we should be talking about those. And I think, you know, Trump overall gets a 9 out of 10 for improving humanity and a 1 out of 10 for
Trump or Musk?
Sorry, Musk, I mean.
Whoops, that was, you gave yourself away there, Keith.
Easy to confuse the
two. You get thrown off the Gilmore Gang when you're giving Donald Trump 9 out of 10.
Yeah, so I think Musk gets a 9 out of 10, but he gets a 1 out of 10 for marketing. And some of his opinions recently, I strongly disagree with. Like, he's become massively anti-immigrant, almost going along with the immigrants are criminals meme.
An immigrant, there's certainly an irony there.
Yeah. So he, you know, you can't really say you're in Musk's camp, because he says things you...
So no statues for the moment for Elon Musk, you're saying?
Maybe a statue of Musk shaped as a starship could be okay, or a car.
I've got sunshine on a cloudy day. When it's cold outside, I've got the money. Everybody say, what can make me feel this way is mine.